Hello, my dear beautiful girls and boys. A very warm good afternoon to all. I'm sorry, good evening to all of you, and thank you very much for staying tuned to HashLearn. And yes, meanwhile, I was going through to M. Joshna. So, Joshna, are you new? Because we have one Joshna already. So, are you the same or you are different? And then Sushant, Indrajit, Pooja, Radhika, all of you, good evening, and thank you very much for staying tuned to HashLearn. Okay. Now, so what is the speciality of today? Tell me, because it's very important. No, what is today's date? 15th. Correct, 15th of September. So, what is the special about this day? Any answer? Okay, you are the same Joshna, I got it. So see, 15th of September is actually celebrated as day for engineers. So yes, I know we are talking about, correct Joshna, it is engineers day. So I could see now only it came your answer. So this is actually celebrated to commemorate the birth anniversary of Sir M. Vishveshwaraya. Okay. So even in Bangalore Metro, when you go, you know, there is one station dedicated on his name. So actually he was an engineer by profession, and he has played very significant role in many of these dams, like Tigra Dam or your Krishna Sagar, that one. So there are many things that he did, and he was also awarded Bharat Ratna. So that's the highest gallantry award or honorary award or civilian award for someone. And today is his birthday, that is 157th birthday. So even today's Google Doodle, if you go through, it is showing his image, and when you take the mouse cursor there, it will show 157th anniversary of Sir M. Vishveshwaraya. Yes, that's Engineers Day, because it is because of that person who was like a marvel in his field. Okay. So the whole thing is that you people are actually perspiring or thinking of what NEET, theek hai, kya banna hai, doctor banna hai. So the thing is, whatever you be, just be the best of your field. Okay, but be the best in your field. That is what I want you people to learn from him. So whatever he did it meticulously. He was the best in his field. So I expect you all also to be the best in your field. Okay, on this note, let's start the class. So now on your screen is the recap of previous class, what we have discussed in the previous class. Okay, meanwhile, even I can see Tamanna has also joined with flowers. Now, what we have discussed in the previous class, we were discussing about mutation breeding, then plant breeding for resistance of to insect and pest. So pest resistance, insect resistance, so either that can be induced. Okay, so the genes are already there, we just do hybridization or transferring gene from one cell to the other cell. And then we also discussed about plant breeding for improved food quality. Under that, it was biofortification and all the new developments, like new plants which are developed for protein enriched or vitamin enriched or what, by IARI. Okay, so in this case, the CPP question which was given to you, where most of you have gone wrong, is from the last segment, that is plant breeding for improved food quality. Okay, so the question was question number 10, which of the following is not protein enriched developed by IARI. Okay, so protein enriched plant, this was, so I remember I gave you the example as beans. So many different varieties of beans, so French beans, garden peas, lublub is again a variety of bean only. So all these are rich in protein, enriched, like they have protein more than the normal, jitna normal hota hai usse zyada hai unme. And why? Because they have done some modifications in their genome, but this variety of mustard, which was developed by IARI, that was rich in vitamin C, along with some like tomato variety also it was there. Okay, so that you need to remember. That's why I said these examples are important. Name of the plant, for which constituent it is, whether it is for some kind of a nutrition or it is for some kind of pest or insect resistance or disease resistance, whatever it is, in specific, and the name of the crop, that is important. Okay. So French beans are just a variety of bean only. Okay, Tamanna, you got it. And Shubham, thank you very much for staying tuned since afternoon, and even Sushant also. Again, he will be like, ma'am, aap ne mujhe ignore kar diya, main bhi tha, tum bhi the, so thank you very much. Now, what are we going to discuss today? That is the last part of this chapter, that is single cell protein, and then tissue culture, then after that the different applications of tissue culture. So though it looks simple, just focus on that. You need, again in this case, we just need to remember a few specific things and a few specific terms for that. Okay, and before I begin the class, one important announcement is that on Monday, that is on coming Monday, that is 17th of September, biology class will be from 5:30 to 6:30. That's only for Monday. Okay, so by the end of the class I may forget this, so that's why I have informed. So there is a change in the schedule, overall schedule. As far as bio is concerned, you will have it from 5:30 to 6:30, followed by maths, if at all there is some math student. Okay, and then from 7:30 to 8:30 you will have physics, due to some urgency to the faculty. Okay, so that's well, that is the thing, but your class will be at this slot, so just freeze it, lock it. Theek hai, yaad karke rakho, Monday ko main 5:30 baje aaungi. Show ka time change hua hai. So let's start. So single cell protein, so what is single cell protein? See, this is what? Okay, Sushant is writing. Okay, thank you Sushant for watching the first video. Now let's focus on here. Single cell protein. So yahan pe kya, you can see you have the single cell. So here we are moving away from the crop, jo general crop hai hamara, usse we are moving away, and we are moving into the microorganism level. But as the name is a bit deceiving, because single cell protein does not always mean it will be a single cell microorganism. It can be even multicellular filamentous organism. Okay, so in this case what will happen, that we are targeting small microorganism. It can be algae, it can be fungi, it can be yeast, or it can be bacteria. Okay, and why we are targeting them? Because there are some which can produce, the amount of protein in them will be more in one cell as compared to what we eat, the general crops which we have. So this is very helpful in meeting the nutritional demand. If you recall the previous class, usme humne kya baat kiya tha ki there something called hidden hunger. Though you are eating, okay, your body will be deficient of nutrition. Second thing, there are many people who cannot afford proper meal. So for them also, if we can make something which is with small amount itself, the nutritional demand is fulfilled, then it is a good to go thing. Okay, so in that case, single cell protein is very, very useful. And further, its even production is not that very expensive. It is very economic, because they require very less nutrition, that we will discuss. Okay, so what is single cell protein? Single cell proteins can be produced from algae, fungi, yeast and bacteria, and one more, it is not single, it can be multicellular also. Okay, then some low cost substrates are used to produce microbial biomass. So see, low cost substrate, that means what we are providing. Say for example, here we have the spirulina. Okay, spirulina can be grown easily on materials like waste water from potato processing plant. अब इससे सस्ता सब्सट्रेट क्या होगा? Waste water जिसको हम सीधे फेंक देते हैं, उस पे you are getting protein rich cells. So that's the cheapest thing we can have. Then even the straw, molasses, animal manure, even sewage to produce large quantities can serve food rich in protein. So what can be more beneficial? और इससे ज़्यादा जादू वाली बात तो मुझे नज़र नहीं आती कि from this kind of a substrate, if we can get something which is beneficial to mankind, then yes, we should give a thumbs up to that. Okay. So it is low cost. Yes, for protein deficiency, that is protein and energy malnutrition, because India is also facing this problem of malnutrition. So for keeping all those thing also in mind, we should not, like we should promote, not we should not, we should promote single cell protein culture. Oh, that's a good one, Shubham. I just noticed French ke garden mein protein se bharpoor peas dekhkar lab lab ho gaya. That's a very good mnemonic. So all those who are watching may have a note of that. So you can actually make your own mnemonics also, because I was also working on that to find out somewhere ki kaise yaad karna hai, that I can tell you people, or I can make out my own mnemonics. So that's a good try, Shubham. Well done. So we were at single cell protein. So what are they? They are high in protein content and then low in fat content. So जो कि आजकल सब चाहते हैं, we do not want more of fat, but please don't say we do not want any fat, because fat is very much important for proper growth of your body. Excess of fat is yes, not needed. Then high quality protein. So these two makes it even more advantageous. Then hence it is desirable by human food. And one more thing about spirulina, I would like to talk, like these days even spirulina biscuits capsules are available, कि जिसमें स्पायरुलिना इज एडेड सो दैट योर प्रोटीन रिक्वायरमेंट इज फुलफिल्ड. अदर देन दैट यू हैव दीज आर प्रोटीन कैप्सूल्स विच इज मेड आउट ऑफ स्पायरुलिना. सो इफ यू टेक वन कैप्सूल अ डे, योर प्रोटीन रिक्वायरमेंट इज डन फॉर द डे. एंड मेनी केस दिस स्पायरुलिना थिंग इज ऑल्सो बींग यूज फॉर डायबिटीज ट्रीटमेंट, टू लोअर द ब्लड शुगर लेवल फॉर डायबिटिक पेशेंट्स. So these are really something miraculous, but what they are finding trouble, where they are finding trouble, this SCPs, is the acceptance from people. Microorganism khayenge, this kind of an attitude is there ki ab vegetables and cereals chhod ke hum microorganism khayenge. But yes, even mushrooms, earlier you will find, if you go to elder generation, they will be like it's fungus and all they will have and they will not eat, but we know that mushrooms are very rich in protein. But nowadays it is plentifully available in market and people have wholeheartedly accepted that also. So we can just think and pray that in coming days even single cell proteins will be accepted by the people. Okay, SCP, and why? Because it has an advantage that SCP should also reduce the pressure on agriculture production system for supply of proteins, and it can reduce environmental pollution as well, because we can see that the substrate is low cost. Okay, from here we, you can see that the substrate which generally will cause the pollution, that we are using for making something good. Okay, so obviously it is helping in reducing environmental pollution. So this is something kind of a boon to mankind, and we should use that. Okay, now let us discuss some of the examples, like spirulina. I have just said, so what is spirulina? Spirulina is nothing but a cyanobacteria. Okay, then if we talk about bacteria itself, proper bacteria, then in that, like I think in the last class Tamanna was posting this name, Methylophilus Methylotropus. Okay, because, and one more thing important about these single cell organism is that they have very high reproductive capacity. Okay, fission bahut zyada hai, so in the same time frame, within 24 hours or something, you can get a big amount of biomass, which is not possible in traditional system of cultivation. And also this can be done throughout the year in lab. Okay, single cell protein culture can be done throughout the year, whereas we cannot get every crop throughout the year with the same productivity. So that is again an advantage of using single cell proteins to fulfill the nutritional requirement. Similarly, we have yeasts like Saccharomyces cerevisiae, that is what we are using, right? So even yeast can be used. Then filamentous fungi, that's why I said that it is not always single cell, filamental fungi also. And then you have algae like chlorella and all, that is also used as single cell protein. In your book it's just one example, two examples are there, this one and spirulina. So consider them as more important, and rest also you can remember. Okay, so that is there. So single cell protein are really good to go. Okay, and the advantages I have already said. And now let's move into the next topic for today, that is tissue culture. Yes, kwashiorkor is such kind of a disease, Sushant. So what is plant tissue culture? So in this case we are going to culture the tissue. Okay, what is tissue? Again, it is collection of cells performing a specific, similar kind of cells performing a specific task. So tissue culture, in plant tissue culture, it refers to the maintenance and growth of plant cells. Okay, so what exactly we do? Maintenance and growth of plant cells. So maintenance part also comes. Yes, we need to maintain the cells. How and what, I'll just say. Okay, tissues and organs on a suitable synthetic medium in vitro. So what is the difference between in vitro and in vivo? There are two things, in vitro and in vivo. What is the difference between in vitro and in vivo? Hurry up, quick, answer it. And in this case, what exactly is the purpose is, or what is the advantage, that with a small amount of plant cell or tissue we can actually get the entire plant. So now this source of plant tissue, whether it's a tissue cell or whichever part, that is called an explant. Okay, so we take explant, that is the source of tissue or cell from a plant, that is explant, which we use in case of tissue culture. Yes, in vitro means inside tube, not exactly inside tube. In vitro means it is inside a lab, in lab conditions, that means outside the natural source, whereas in vivo is in doing in nature, in the natural habitat of anything. Okay, so that is in vivo and in vitro. In vitro is in lab. So tissue culture, where we do in lab only. Okay, we do not perform tissue culture in the field. So if it would have been performed in field, that would have been in vivo culture. Okay, when we do things in lab, it is in vitro. And yes, in other words, you can also use the word test tube. Not exactly in vitro is not exactly inside the body, it's just the natural and artificial environment. If it is in natural environment, in the natural habitat of the plant, that is in vivo. And if it is in lab, or you can say the test tube, so then it will be in vitro. So Shubham, that's a literal meaning, but when we talk about in experiment, the meaning is this. Okay, so what is an explant? Again, as I explained, an explant is the plant part that is excised from specific location in a plant to be used for initiating a culture. So in tissue culture, what exactly we do, we take some cells from the desired plant part, and then that will be cultured in a nutritive medium. Okay, and then it will also be directed for root and shoot growth. Then in this tissue culture process, explant, any other part of the plant, is taken out and grown in the test tube under sterile conditions. Okay, so this is important. Again, the conditions needs to be sterile. That means it should not be infected with any microorganism, and that is why in case of this, that means tissue culture, or in case of any culture in lab, whether it's related to plant or animal, the conditions they maintain, it should be sterility, okay, that it should not be infected, very hygienic conditions. All the instruments that we use, whether it's a petri dish or the needle or anything, it needs to be sterilized, okay. And the instruments are generally autoclaved, so that's again another system altogether. So in that I'm not moving, but yes, it needs to be infection or pathogen free. This capacity to generate the whole plant from a cell, it's called totipotency. So here again we are introducing one more word from bio, that is totipotency. So totipotency kya, it is the capacity of a cell to give rise to the entire structure, that is called totipotency. Okay, in case of plant, it is to generate the whole plant, that is totipotency. Say for example, the embryo which is formed after fertilization, that is a totipotent cell, because it can give rise to the entire human being, if we talk about us, or any plant or organism. The embryo is totipotent because it can give rise to any kind of cell. It has not undergone any kind of differentiation. After differentiation process, what happens is the cell is specified, okay, कि नो, इट हैज़ टू बिकम ओनली द सेल्स ऑफ अ पर्टिकुलर पार्ट. लाइक इसको मेरिस्टेमेटिक टिश्यू ही रह जाना है, और इसको पेरेनकाइमाटस बनना है, इसको स्क्लेरेनकाइमा बनना है, इसको कोलेनकाइमा बनना है. सो दैट इज द डिफरेंट पैरामीटर्स, एंड दिस प्रोसेस ऑफ अटेनिंग स्पेशलाइजेशन इज डिफरेंशिएशन. ओके, सो इन दिस एंटायर इवेंट व्हेन वी आर टेकिंग एनी टिश्यू ऑफ अ प्लांट पार्ट, तो उसमें क्या हो रहा है, दैट्स ऑलरेडी डिफरेंशिएटेड. ठीक है, इफ वी आर टेकिंग a tissue from the stem, that is differentiated. Again, if we are taking even the meristematic tissue, that is differentiated already. So one major thing around which the entire tissue culture revolve is dedifferentiation and redifferentiation. This differentiation is very much different from your maths ka integration and differentiation. Okay, कितने भावुक हो जा रहे हैं बच्चे लोग प्लांट पढ़ते पढ़ते ही. बताओ, पोल्यूशन पढ़ाएंगे तो क्या होगा, रो दोगे तुम लोग. वॉट एग्जैक्टली यू आर डूइंग टू द एनवायरमेंट, इतने भावुक मत हो. Somatic embryoids, we will come to that also. Joshna, just wait. Okay, so here exactly what happens, so the entire tissue culture revolves around these two process, ki already differentiated tissue hai, we have already differentiated, then we need to de-differentiate them, okay, so that they become totipotent and they can give rise to the entire plant part, provided we provide them proper nutritional media. Then after de-differentiation, once the cells have become de-differentiated, unko pata hi nahi hai kya hai, nahi hai, they will, like mostly the callus which is there, it is parenchymatous. Then they will be again subjected to re-differentiation. From that cell, we put nutritive media in such a way that shoot will come. So that is again differentiation. So you have differentiated, de-differentiation, and then we re-differentiate into a complete plant part. Good one, Tamanna. So now this method of producing thousands of plants through tissue culture is micropropagation. So again, this is a word introduction. When we produce more number of plants, and in actually thousands, when the plants are produced by a small amount of tissue through tissue culture, that is called micropropagation. Okay, and each of these plants will be genetically identical to original plant from which they were grown, and that is why it is called soma clones. Okay, because the cell which we have taken, that only is dividing. Yahan na hum hybridization kar rahe hain, na fertilization kar rahe hain, so there is no mixing of genome. Jab mixing of genome hoga hi nahi from the same cell, it is just mitotic division, so obviously the entire plant will be the same. Okay, so this is again, you can say it's another artificial kind of vegetative propagation. Why artificial? Because it is done by human beings. redifferentiation example is that only, dear, from callus when we put if auxin cytokinin ratio is more, so if cytokinin is more, shoot will grow. So from that callus, which is which is totipotent, which can give rise to any kind of cell, but you are redifferentiating it into shoot. Is that clear, Joshna? Okay, so that's why these plants which we get from tissue culture, they are called soma clones. And now on your screen is the contest from previous contest question from previous class. So it asked about Pusa Komal is a variety of cauliflower, A cauliflower, B cowpea, C chili, D brassica. So actually, as far as I remember, initially only three of you answered it correctly. Okay, and in that also the person to answer it correctly and the first person is actually Radhika. So a big round of applause for Radhika, and the correct answer was actually B. Okay, B is cow, is Komal, so it's cowpea. And congratulations, Radhika, you will get your atom session credited, free atom session credited by the end of this class. And now on your screen will come today's contest question. Sushant, you were not supposed to answer this question. You are supposed to answer the next question. Okay. And here it goes. So just do it fast. Identify the incorrectly matched pair. A is wheat, Himgiri. So basically you have variety and whether it is correctly matched with the counterpart or not. So Himgiri is a variety of wheat, Sahiwal is a breed for milch breed, and then Ratna is a variety of rice, Brassica or Pusha Subra is a variety of Brassica. So I can see many of you have answered. Now the question will go off your screen on my count of 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and here we go. So we were into tissue culture. Now from tissue culture only comes somatic hybridization. Okay, so in the first step in somatic hybridization is to remove the cell wall by digesting it with enzymes, pectinase or cellulase. So what is actually somatic hybridization? Somatic word has come for somatic cells. Okay, so the cells which are not your reproductive cells, the germ line cells ko chhod ke sare cells are somatic cells. Now somatic hybridization, that means we have to hybridize or fuse two somatic cells. So when fusion of two somatic cell comes, the major problem in that, or in case of a plant cell, is that they have a cell wall. Okay, behind the plasma membrane. Okay, so cell wall hai, and then so this cell wall needs to be broken, otherwise it's very tough and it will be difficult to fuse the two. So that is why this will be removed, and even you have the middle lamella. So in that case we are using these enzymes to digest the pectinase, for to digest the pectin, and cellulase to digest the cellulose in the cell wall, so that the cell wall gets ruptured and then it will be easy for fusion of the two protoplasts. Okay, so what we do in these two cases, the protoplast from two different varieties of a plant. So this is important, or this is an significance of somatic hybridization. Okay, because usually when we perform hybridization by emasculation method, okay, or pollen transfer method, so that in that mostly successful thing kya hota hai, it is the one which is within the species. If within the variety we do, it is successful. But if we have to do interspecific or intergeneric, in that case this somatic hybridization is very useful. So we can get two somatic cells of two different genera, and which have our desirable characters, and they can be fused to get a hybrid protoplast. So once this cell wall is removed, you have the protoplast, it can be fused. Okay, so you will get one cell or hybridized cell which has all the genes of both the somatic cells. So that is an important and significant thing which we can get only through this method and not by any other method. And then this can be grown, okay, into small plantlets and then transferred into the field to get a new plant. And this kind of hybrids are called somatic hybrids, which while the process is called somatic hybridization. So, pure process ko hum kya bolte hai? Somatic hybridization. And these hybrids are called somatic hybrids. Say for example, like in your book it's there already. Ki scientists have already been trying to make hybrids. Okay, so hybrids in terms of what? Actually, like the suppose a plant is there which has useful roots. Say for example, the potato. Tomato has useful shoot. So if we can mix and if we can get these two desired qualities, so from the same area of plant with the same nutrition, everything same, we will get two crops. Okay, two crops can be obtained. So that is an advantage, and we have been trying to do that even with other things where you have the root is useful, like carrot, radish, and all. And then where shoot is useful, so if we can mix it and we can get it, that will be really helpful for the farmers as well as for the people. Okay. Now, so let's quickly think of what we do in tissue culture, and then we will move into the application of tissue culture, like where and all it is used. So, tissue culture, mein first thing what we need to have a what we need it is an explant. ठीक है, the tissue which is there. Now, this explant is cultured in a medium, generally an agar medium, okay, or it can be a suspension culture also. So there are two kinds of culture, callus culture and suspension culture. Okay, so callus culture is the culture where we allow this cell to divide and form a mass of cell. So this undifferentiated mass of cell will be called as callus. Whereas in case of suspension culture, the nutritive media or the it is liquid, whereas when we take agar, it is a solid medium, okay, on which the cells grow. So in that, when we put the cell, okay, so cell will grow, okay, and then that is agitated again. So these cells will simply form a suspension in the solution, and then the cell will keep dividing. So that is called suspension culture. So in any of these two ways we can do the culture. Okay, then once the callus is ready, now what we need, we need the root and shoot formation. So first what is done is the shoot formation. So now this will be transferred, you have the callus and the medium. Okay, and in medium what is generally we provide, it should have inorganic components. Okay, inorganic nutritional components, organic like sucrose, glucose, which will be consumed by the cells, because when the cells grow from, or when the plant grows from seeds, it will use the food stored in the seed itself. But when we are doing it in tissue culture, we need to provide it. So we need to provide it with all inorganic, organic, okay, and then also with hormones. Now in hormone context only, the ratio of auxin to cytokinin plays a very vital role. If we put more of cytokinin as compared to auxin, then it will induce shoot formation in the callus. Okay, so in the next step, when we put more of cytokinin and less of auxin, so what will happen in these cells, the shoot formation will take place. But remember, the root has not formed yet. In second step, in the hormone supply, the hormone auxin will be increased. As a result, what will happen? It will develop the root. So now the plantlet is ready. This plantlet will be taken from here and it will be grown in the lab first. Then before sending this plantlet into the field, there is a process called hardening. Okay, because see, this culture or this plantlet which is obtained, it is in highly sterile medium. Isko pata hi nahi hai pathogen kya hota hai, bimari kya hoti hai. Theek hai, so unless it identifies that, or unless it is not subjected to the environmental conditions, the moment it goes in field, it is so fragile, hai na? Like it is highly pampered plant, you can say. Pampered bacche hote hain, वैसे this is a highly pampered plant. So this, if you put directly into the field, it will die of diseases. Okay. So for that reason, we do hardening. What is hardening? In the lab's environment only, we will provide artificially the conditions which resembles the environment, so that the plant it can withstand real environmental conditions. Is that clear to everyone? Because in my screen, the last comment. Okay. See, other plant hormones are also used here, gibberellin or abscisic acid. Abscisic acid pehle hi dal doge Sushant kya? Okay. No, plant hormones which are there, it will be used whenever it is required, but majorly for shoot promotion or root promotion, we use auxin cytokinin ratio difference. Okay. So that was the tissue culture. Good. So now in tissue culture, we will just see the some of the applications or some of the ways in which this tissue culture is differently used. Okay. Say for example, the first one, as I have discussed, you have the callus culture or suspension culture. The steps will remain the same, but in that again, application first is micropropagation, which I have already said. So in micropropagation, from a small amount of the cell or tissue, we can get multiple plants. So that's again an advantage that if suppose we do not have the plant in plenty available, agar hum normal vegetative propagation ke liye jaate, we will cut the stem or the plant part, the plant bachega hi nahi. But here with small amount of tissue, we will get many. Okay. Then the second thing is production of disease free plant. So by chance any plant gets a disease, or there is a plant is affected by chronic disease, so in that case we can take the meristematic tissue or meristem, plant meristem, and that can be cultured, and we can make disease free plants, or we can get disease free plant again. But now the question comes, why meristems only? Why not other part of the cell? And why meristems remains virus free? Suppose a plant is infected with virus, so why we say that the meristematic tissue, the axillary buds or apical meristem, shoot apical meristem, will be free of this virus or the pathogen? That is the question. Answer it. Meanwhile, I'll write the third application, that is androgenic haploid. Or this is also called anther culture. Okay. Good. So Sushant has actually made a good attempt. So meristematic cells, actually we know that this has a very high dividing capacity. So the pathogen which is there, it cannot match up with the dividing capacity of the meristematic tissue, and that is one of the reason why the shoot meristem or the meristematic tissue will remain free from this virus. So in this case, the apical meristem will be taken, and that you can perform the tissue culture, and we can get disease free plants. Okay. Multiplication property, plus it second thing, one more reason can be there, that it doesn't have any vascular tissue supply, it's just meristematic tissue, so again it makes difficult for the pathogen to enter into the meristematic zone. Now next thing is androgenic haploid, or this is also called anther culture. So in this case, what happens, we take the pollens. Okay, from there the microspores which are there, that will be cultivated. So in this case, what we get is an haploid plant. Okay, and this is a very significant thing, and this was in case of India, this was first done in the plant Datura inoxica by two gentlemen, that is Guha and Maheshwari. Okay, and that too in University of Delhi. So And this has played an important role again in plant breeding, because in this case we can get haploid, and remember haploid has just one set, so it is helpful in getting homozygous pure lines. How? By C, you will get two haploid cells or two haploid plants, then allow protoplasm fusion. So the, in that case we will get homozygous condition, which saves time from, which is invested in inbreeding. Okay, in plant breeding you remember we have talked about creation of pure lines, or under animal breeding also. So pure line creation mein kya hai, you have to do inbreeding for many generation, but by this method that can be skipped. So earlier the process which used to take some 10 years, that can be done in just small amount of time. Okay, so that, like, that is there, we save the time and energy as well. So that is significant in getting homozygous pure lines. Then the next thing which is there, you have induction and selection of mutants. Selection of mutants plus induction also. So this is helpful in identifying. We need not to wait for the plant to show the phenotype. Okay, you just take the cells. Suppose we are talking about induction of any disease resistance, or it is resistant to some chemical. So kya karoge cell mein, whether it has come or not, we will just take, culture the cell. We will have different sets, add the chemicals to that. The cells which will survive that particular chemical, okay, that means it is resistant to that particular chemical or anything to which you are trying to develop the resistance. Okay, so that's how with this tissue culture itself we can identify whether the plant has got our desired property or not. Okay, then we have somaclonal variations. Somaclonal variations are the variations which will be created in the somatic cells. Okay, so that can also be done with the help of tissue culture. Next we have the protoplast technology. So in this case we have the fusion of protoplast. So protoplast, as I have discussed, there can be self fusion also, so that is called self fusion, but protoplast fusion can be induced also. And for induction of protoplast fusion we use chemicals like polyethylene glycol or sodium nitrate. Okay, so these are some of the chemicals which are used for induced protoplast fusion, even like calcium ion at high pH, that also can be used. Okay, now someone asked, I think Joshna asked about embryoids. Okay, so that comes under embryo rescue. Okay, or embryoids are actually the ones which see, embryoids are not the actual embryo. Okay, so what happens, these cells, even in case of other like ovary culture, we do ovule culture also. So ovule culture is diploid, anther culture is haploid. So in those cases, by application of nutrients and all, we can make the cell as an embryo. Okay, so that it follows that all torpedo stage and all, but that has not come from a true embryo, the fertilized ovule. So that kind of an embryo is called as embryoids. Okay, so that also can be done with the help of tissue culture. Other than this, we can also make like artificial seeds, the plants for which we have less seeds. In that case we can just, oh, that looks very clumsy, I'm very sorry for that. So artificial seeds are the ones where for plants if you have less of seeds, so by tissue culture method we can grow more number of seeds. Also like if some plants we believe that in near future it's going to be extinct, okay, So in that case, we can do cryopreservation of the genes. Okay. So in that case, we can preserve those genes because we know we any time we can switch back to wild. Haan, theek hai, agar wild mein we have the desired gene. Agar wo hai wild mein, so we need to preserve it because we don't know when we will need it. But when we need it, should be available. It should not be extinct. So that is why we do cryopreservation of the tissues. So overall, these were the applications for plant tissue culture, and with this we have come to an end of the class. And what we have discussed today is the single cell protein and the tissue culture. So in all these cases, you need to remember the examples, what are they in case of single cell protein as well as in case of tissue culture. So the entire step and the terms, like you have somatic hybridization or micropropagation or totipotency, what it is, and in general what are they, and whether it's haploid, diploid, these you need to remember. Okay. So thank you very much for joining the class, and I hope you have enjoyed the class. Yes, there is a difference between embryo and embryoids, dear Joshna. So if time permits, I'll discuss that again in the coming class so that it becomes more clear. Okay. So embryoids, it's kinds of induced, you can say. Okay. And all the other questions I will discuss in the next class. So thank you very much for joining, and I hope you have liked the class. And now the CPP gift will be given to you. So please do solve the CPP question. Shubham, I have said 110 times, I do not ignore the question. I may miss the question. I will take your question. Don't worry, beta. Why do you people keep taking things on heart? Okay. Please don't do that. Okay. And on this note, I'll just take your leave. Okay. Good night. Shubhratri. Shabakhair. And do remember that on Monday, bio class is from 5:30 to 6:30, and passport user starts solving the question right away. Good luck.